Welcome to our conversation about the film showcase, Stories from Behind the Iron Curtain, put together by the Polish Embassy in Washington, D.C. and Polish Film Festival in Miami. My name is Urszula Horoszko. I'm the head of public diplomacy here at the Polish Embassy in Washington, D.C. I'm with Sean Keeley, associate editor of the American Interest. Sean's interests include foreign policy with particular emphasis on the post-Soviet countries, as well as the culture and the arts. He co-produces the American Interest podcast and organizes and leads the excellent The American Interest / Stanford and Washington film series. We are also joined by Eva Baker. She's joining us from Miami. She's a co-founder and the director of the Polish Film Festival in Miami and a co-host of the retrospective Stories from Behind the Iron Curtain. Let us talk a bit about the idea behind creating the Stories from Behind the Iron Curtain, a showcase of recent Polish films about the experience of communism. By putting this series together, we wanted to first and foremost shed some light on the new exciting Polish film and exciting Polish cinema from the past decade. Polish cinema, as we all know, has great traditions with classics such as Andrzej Wajda, Wojciech Has, Krzysztof Kieślowski, and they hardly need any additional introductions. Yes. Polish cinema has been enjoying a comeback in the recent years, evidenced by back-to-back Academy Awards nominations for International Feature Film, for Corpus Christi last year and Cold War, and Oscar for Paweł Pawlikowski's Ida, as well as the most recent win, the Tribeca Film Festival Best International Narrative Feature awarded to Jan Komasa's The Hater. This is also a year of two very important anniversaries for Poland, and this showcase directly engages with these anniversaries. The first one is an important anniversary for the entire world. It's the end of the World War II in 1945, the particular moment in world history that brought Poland peace, but it didn't bring us freedom. It pretty much denounced our freedom for another 45 years. And another important historical anniversary that we would like to engage with or draw your attention to is the birth of Solidarity in 1980. Solidarity, the first free labor union and the first truly mass anti-communist political and moral movement that sort of established itself formally in the summer of 1980. And it helped eventually to bring freedom to all of the Central and Eastern Europe and about a decade after the birth of Solidarity. And the protagonists of the three films that we are going to screen for you, Reverse by Boris Lankos, Little Rose by Janki Dawa-Błoński, All That I Love by Jacek Bortuk. They all grapple with the post-World War II reality of communist rule in Poland and its aftermath. Beginning with the early years of Stalinism in Poland depicted in Boris Lankos's Reverse. These films were made within a couple of years between 2009 and 2011. And they are all great examples of accessible and commercially successful genre films. There's a comedy, there are two romances. This showcase is very much possible thanks to Eva Baker and the Polish Film Festival in Miami. Thank you, Eva, for joining the project and for joining us here today. Would you kindly say a few words about the Miami Film Festival, how and why it was born? It's a very young festival, about 2.5 years old. And why it is a good idea to show Polish films in Miami?
Sure. First and foremost, thank you so much for inviting us and for inviting us to collaborate on this very exciting project. Polish Film Festival started 2 years ago, 2.5 years ago, exactly in January of 2018. As a pretty, obviously exciting and new initiative in Miami. I lived in Los Angeles for 14 years prior to moving to Miami 5.5 years ago. So I volunteered for Polish Film Festival Los Angeles for number of years. I'm actually still on the organizing committee as on some sort of consultant basis. I do marketing and a little bit of advertising for them. So we knew in Miami, you know, there's apparently a lot of Polish people, and Miami is a very exciting place. It's very diverse culturally. There's a very strong art community. And we knew this, you know, we would follow the template of other international film festivals and Polish film festivals across the United States and Canada. So we sort of knew that this was necessary, it was needed, it sounded like a very exciting project. And in January of 2018, we formed a nonprofit organization. And in 9 months, it's basically just like giving birth to a baby, I guess. Polish first edition inaugural Polish Film Festival Miami took place. And then we followed with an exciting, bigger and better festival in November of 2019. And then in 2020, as we wrapped last year's festival, we started working on our third edition. And of course, life as we know it changed for a foreseeable future. And then we decided to basically cancel this year's activities. And literally after I closed all the, you know, all the particulars, I got a call from Ula and Dagmara, and this new collaboration started. So it's almost like a rebirth of Polish Film Festival Miami in some sort of virtual online Zoom form. So we're looking forward to this exciting year of what's left of it.
Thank you, Eva. Over to Sean. And I was wondering, Sean, if you could say a little bit more about your involvement with cinema, about what is maybe appealing to you in Polish cinema, because I know you've screened some Polish films before, and the ways in which you value cinema also as a sort of teaching tool or a document of a particular political, historical situation in a particular country or a part of the world.
Sure. Well, thank you. I'm really happy to be involved here. And, you know, my interest in film goes back as long as I can remember, you know, from my childhood. But I particularly became interested in Polish cinema in late high school, early college. I started watching Krzysztof Kieślowski. I discovered his films, and I had a college professor who would screen episodes of the Decalogue for us and lead discussions that way. And I was really captivated by those films because they were so universally relatable, these moral dilemmas that they were working through based on the Ten Commandments, but it was also so clearly anchored in this time and place of late communist Poland. As Urszula, as you mentioned, with my work at the American Interest, which is a magazine of politics and culture based in DC, I started to lead up this film series that we started last year in 2019, which was the 30th anniversary of the fall of communism, the fall of the Berlin Wall. And, you know, the idea there was to kind of engage these questions about historical legacies and memories of communism through a slightly different format rather than just publishing articles. And so we convened a series of films and discussions, one from, you know, each of three countries. So we did Goodbye Lenin with Germany. We did a film called 1208 East of Bucharest from Romania. And then we did Three Colors White by Kieślowski. And you were kind enough to participate in with that along with the Polish ambassador. And I think that, you know, film can just be a really great way of introducing viewers from any country to a different reality, a different historical experience and perspective that is not their own, that you can read about what it's like to live in communist Poland or what have you, but to actually see it brought to life in the way that these films do, and I think a lot of the best Polish cinema does, is another thing entirely, so.
All right, thank you. Reverse by Boris Lankos is a film about the first years of Stalinism in Poland. It was one of the most memorable films of the year. It was very much commented on, watched. People were very excited about it, largely because it also brought this new way of talking about Polish history to light. It initiated in many ways a new way of speaking about history in the Polish cinema, most recent Polish cinema. And if you sort of follow the last 10, 15 years of Polish cinema, Pawlikowski's films, for instance, they sort of use a similar convention. They are also shot in black and white. And in some ways, Lankos's film can be thought about as one that started that new sort of language. What is very interesting about this film is this sort of genre, it is a genre mix. So it's a romance, it's a pastiche of film noir, it's a comedy, it's a social satire, it's a historical satire, it plays with the conventions of dark comedy, but also uses sort of tools that are characteristic of a theatrical play. And this, I think, allusion to almost theater of the absurd and like Beckett, that there is this sort of these scenes of this immobilized matriarch of the film that's also, that's almost like a character from Beckett's Happy Days, who also sort of is seen only from sort of waist up. There's also an allusion or sort of a strong indication of the foundational myth of the Palace of Culture and Science. And a monument, a building erected by, funded by Stalin and erected in the early years of Stalinism in Poland. And this film, in this way, I think, brings us back to this very contemporary Polish, not just Polish, but very much true in Poland about Poland as well, debate about the relics of communism and sort of the monuments and the ways in which we can engage with them. Should we keep them? Should we repurpose them? Should we demolish them? Sean, Reverse is a modern retro movie, so to speak, and it plays with these tropes, like film, tropes of film noir, for instance, that are very much recognizable as a part of a tradition of American cinema. Was it clear to you? What do you think the director did with these tropes? Is that something that resonates with you and that would resonate with the American audiences? Is it valuable to view these films in the sort of context of these tropes?
Yeah, I think it definitely is. And it's funny that you mentioned Humphrey Bogart as a reference point for the Bronislaw character. And I had a very similar thought when I was first watching it. You know, he's wearing this long trench coat and smoking out in the rain, and the whole film is shot, at least the scenes in the 50s are shot in this kind of shadowy black and white cinematography that very much calls to mind film noir. But what's interesting to me too is how the movie kind of blends these different genres. So, you know, there are parts that, as you say, verge on the absurd and that are quite funny. Some of Sabina's early dates with, you know, her suitors who end up, you know, being these kind of drunken fools who aren't worth her time. And then,
tragedy of sort of good men.
Yeah, exactly. And then, you know, it takes a dark turn, but it's kind of a dark comedy, almost like a like the Coen brothers are an American reference point, I think, about where it's the mixture of absurdity and violence and humor. And then, you know, there is a stretch in, you know, the first half of the film where you think it's going in kind of a romantic direction, and then it doesn't quite fulfill those expectations. So I thought Lankos did a really nice job of blending all those different genre tropes and also kind of misdirecting the viewer, so you weren't quite sure where it was going.
Do you think that this film makes the time period sort of more available to contemporary audience, or rather that it sort of takes the history and does something else with it?
I think it's maybe a little bit of both. I think that maybe Lankos, as a younger director, you know, has the necessary distance to be able to approach some of these themes in this time period in a slightly lighter or more offbeat way. But I think the movie also does capture the darkness of that period, the sense of mistrust between different factions of society who are communicating almost in a whisper about, you know, even very recent history, like the Warsaw Uprising. I think Sabina asks one of her male suitors kind of in a coded way about his involvement in that. And of course, that would have been a very taboo thing to talk about. And I think, again, that, you know, the kind of shadowy black and white atmosphere of the film, you know, on the one hand, it kind of captures the beauty of Warsaw in a very nice way, but it also has this kind of dark, imposing quality to it that feels a little bit stifling. And I guess one other impression I have about the movie is it's really good at chronicling both like public and private personas and the way people react to a regime like the early Stalinist regime. So, you know, one scene that really stuck in my mind is when Stalin's death is announced, and you know, out on the streets, people are kind of performatively crying about it. And then Sabina and her mother duck into a courtyard and start like doing a little dance of joy. And it's just so clear that divide between your public persona and how you present, you know, to go along with a system and just for survival's sake, and then what you're actually really feeling on the inside.
Great, thank you. So, Eva, you were in a unique position because you were in LA 10 years ago when the film was first screened when it seemed like Lankos had the shot at an Oscar.
Yes, so full disclosure, I watched the film again last night after 10 years of since 2009, and that's where I actually met Boris Lankos in LA about 10 years ago, 10, 11 years ago. Yeah, so I totally agree. It's a story of absurdity of communism, Stalinism, and just in a, you know, absurdity of a regime system in general. Yes, it's an excellent film, perfectly shot, that black and white, that darkness, and that the bleakness of life. So I think he depicted it in a very exquisite way.
Okay, so thank you. Maybe let's move on to Urszula. And Urszula, going by this timeline that we set up, it's a film that takes us over a decade into the future, into the Polish 1968 political crisis. It was a series of major student, intellectual, and other protests against the communist regime. The crisis was met with brutal force, used by the security forces across the country, and the subsequent repressions of the Polish dissident movement, including arrests and often lengthy prison sentences for the participants. It was also accompanied by mass immigration following an anti-Semitic, or what the communists called an anti-Zionist campaign, waged by the highest leaders of the Communist Party. The protests overlapped with the events of the Prague Spring in Czechoslovakia, raising new hopes of democratic reforms. Jan Kidawa-Błoński's letter Rose, like Reverse, is also set in Warsaw, which is very important because it's a center of power. It's the center of power in Poland, in particular in communist Poland. The film alludes to widely known cases of sort of documented reporting on family members. It particularly alludes to a widely known case of Polish historian and essayist Paweł Jasienica, who central character played by Andrzej Seweryn is modeled after. Jasienica was a very popular author and one of the most influential dissidents at the time. Jasienica's wife, Urszula or Kamila is based on, turned out to be an informant planted by the secret police, who wrote reports on her husband and his associates. The case became known many, many years later, after the opening of the secret police archives and secret police files. He definitely shows the ways in which, as Sean mentioned before, the private and the public intersect. And this way in which the public and the private intersect is, for instance, highlighted by the way in which the film is composed and edited, the way that sort of the shots from the official Film Chronicles, official state propaganda, are interspersed and sort of interrupt the film narrative and add this sort of official layer to this very personal story, and show how sort of the political constantly, the historical constantly invades the private. And this whole film, it happened at the time of sort of continued conversation in Poland about the opening of the archives and the merit of opening the archives, finding out about the past, finding out about sort of these kinds of stories that took place in all of the Eastern Bloc. There's an excellent German film on the subject when people were sort of keeping tabs on one another, often very intimate, sort of the most intimate situations. And the debate that's still very much happening in Poland and whether it should or shouldn't be done, in what ways should these materials be available to the public. So Little Rose makes sort of the history the very stuff of romance to the point where they become inseparable. Sean, what was your response to the film? Because it's sort of quite a different film from Reverse.
Well, I really enjoyed the film, and it was kind of a nice follow-on to Reverse, because it's that post-Stalinist period, of course, 1968, but it's the regime has had more time to kind of solidify and establish a hold, and you know, the events of March 1968 are something that I'm aware of, in a general sense, and I've read about it, and I ran an essay a couple of years ago on the 50th anniversary of those events. But again, to see it dramatized in this film over the course of several months and through the prism of this one, romantic melodrama slash spy story really brought it to life for me. You mentioned, a German film that kind of, it was related to this one. Some of the themes, I thought of The Lives of Others, which is a movie a lot of Americans might be familiar with, but it's similarly about how the security services in a communist country will really turn lover against lover, how they, really also place a premium on infiltrating the intelligentsia, the literary circles, and the character of Adam in this film is really representative of that. And I think that, Adam is just a fascinating and kind of tragic character, I think. He feels in many ways to me like he's the repository or the source of Poland's intellectual heritage and this historical memory that's being suppressed and that he's trying to keep alive in his own quiet way. There are specific reference points that I as an American maybe didn't fully understand with the meaning of the play and why that's such a politically charged performance and its relation to Polish intellectual history. But I thought it was a wonderful film, and it really brought alive those events in Poland, and also as it's happening against this wider backdrop, both with the Six-Day War in 1967, the events of the Prague Spring, and so on.
What is interesting, really, that you mentioned the Forefathers' Eve, it's actually available. It's available. It was quite recently translated by an excellent sort of professor of Slavic literature here in the United States, and was published. But it seemed that was the sort of the absurdity of it, right? That it seemed like such an innocuous thing, and it's a play that every Polish child knows. It was never banned. It was never really censored. Everyone knew what it was about. This is like the most prolific and the most sort of well-known period in Polish literature. So pretty much every kid read this book, and still it managed to be put into this sort of grind of the propaganda and censorship and fear. And what is interesting, one of the people who participated in those protests at that time as a very young man was Andrzej Seweryn, who plays the main male protagonist, who is one of the greatest living Polish theater and film actors, and who happens to be sort of like the godfather, if you will, of the Miami Film Festival. So Eva, you mentioned that the first film that you ever sort of showed that you started the festival with was the film that also features Andrzej Seferin. So what's your experience with him?
Sure. So first of all, Andrzej Seferin is it's an amazing person, obviously a great artist, a great actor, and very, very well respected. And he's the sweetest person one could meet. So we were fortunate enough that his schedule allowed him to travel back in 2018 when we all could travel, to travel to Miami so happened in November, which made the case for him visiting Miami a lot easier, considering the weather in Poland in November versus weather in Miami. So we were lucky enough that he agreed in March to reschedule or to work his schedule around our festival in November. Andrzej, being who he is, right in the middle of the festival, he basically, raised his hand and he said, you know what? I have a great idea. I'm going to be a godfather of this festival. Any objections? We were like, no objections. That's it. This is your gig now. You're our godfather.
What was the response to these arguably very sort of difficult films with the difficult subject matter?
Yeah, so exactly. So subject matters are of these films, whether it's Bekshinsky or even Little Rose, sad situation. The regime just destroyed so many relationships, destroyed so many people's lives in so many different ways. In many ways, I discovered a lot of facts and a lot of information, or got a lot of information out of these films myself. So it was, maybe as perhaps sad and difficult and stories are, they're also educational, and that's part of our mission to educate Polish and American audience through films.
I think you're absolutely right that this particular film engages with a moment in Polish history that for a very long time was sort of unavailable to people.
Not two generations of Polish people. We didn't know much about it. Honestly, I learned more about it outside of Poland when I left Poland and ended up in Toronto, Canada. That's where I learned the most about that period of time from fellow Canadian students and professors.
Thank you. And so that takes us to our film and the showcase, which takes us to the early 1980s and the period when Solidarity Movement was born. It's also, one would say, a romantic film, sort of a Bildungsroman, if you can even say that about a movie. But it's a sort of a coming of age story. That is set in a coastal city of in Poland, presumably Gdańsk or near Gdańsk, at the time of sort of mass worker strikes, the Solidarity Carnival, so-called, the August Gdańsk Agreement, and later the martial law, internments, and the mass immigration of 1980s. A question for Eva, because you mentioned that you remember this time period very well, and that you were there when Solidarity was born in Gdańsk. So if you could sort of, and you very much remember the music scene of that time. So if you could sort of tell us a little bit about how you see this movie as a sort of record or as a sort of chronicle of a particular historical moment.
Sure. So yeah. So basically right here, we're checking off all these boxes, 80s, 80s, 80s. where I am, I admit I'm a child of the 80s, so I was actually that little kid also who wanted to listen to the music of my older friends, especially boys. I wanted to be that person singing. I wanted to listen to not just Polish rock and hard rock and punk, emerging punk music, but American rock and American heavy metal. So I was that person that listened to Iron Maiden and AC/DC. And so that checks off one box. Summer of 1981, I was actually there. And being from a small town in southern Poland, we were obviously we didn't know a lot what was happening. And of course, my parents and their friends, we all wanted to know what was going on. And we actually we took like a day trip from that seaside resort to go to Gdańsk, but really under the pretense of going to at least driving by the shipyard to see what was going on. So I remember that, you know, very vividly, being, you know, like 8 or 10 years old. But yes, I was there. And so that just like strikes that chord. And then again, it's a story of coming of age or teenagers. And you know, I was, then I went to a boarding school, a very liberal art school, where we obviously did not agree with anything, with definitely not the regime. And we also all practically looked at the first chance we could get to leave the country.
Because that's very interesting that a lot of the sort of U.S. immigration, Polish immigration, was really from that time, from the 80s, right? When people, and that's sort of, without disclosing too much about the film, but there's sort of this element of people asking themselves, after the martial law is introduced, after the sort of the communist authorities crack down on the solidarity and all the opposition, after people are interned, after they are in prison, whether there's future in this country. Do you remember your parents talking about it? Or was it something that, like, about solidarity? Or do you remember sort of it being kind of a bit of a secret?
A bit of a secret. And also, like I said, you know, the information would just trickle down, from Warsaw, from cities, from larger towns to, you know, smaller towns, especially in southern Poland. So from what I remember, we just didn't quite have access, although I know Radio Free Europe was, pretty much on at all times that was available in my household. So so definitely it was very present. It was very, somewhat tangible, yet without access to a broad access to information.
And guys, in particular, because I think it's important also to mention that there's sort of the Gdańsk shipyard is in many ways considered as one of the sort of cradles and is the most symbolic of sort of the solidarity as a movement. But it was a truly mass movement. It was sort of workers and intelligentsia and sort of middle class working together. And what was really interesting, that pretty much every city, every town that had sort of a factory of, it would have often a very robust solidarity unit. So it was sort of where people would be engaged and people would be sort of organizing. And it was all the more tragic when that sort of all that effort, all that sort of engagement, all that risk that people took was sort of destroyed by the introduction of the martial law in December 1981. So Sean, over to you. I'm curious about your thoughts about this film, because it's sort of, as I mentioned, it's in many ways sort of the most contemporary looking film, I think, of the three. Maybe since you watched all of these films from other post-communist countries, in what ways do you maybe see the parallels between All That I Love and other films that engage with similar stories from a similar time period?
Yeah, I was really struck from the very beginning how the style is so different from the other two films. It feels a little bit more scrappy and raw. And, you know, the very first scene, you've got these kids, you know, screaming, and I think an abandoned bus as they're rehearsing the punk music. And you just immediately feel like you're in a different era, both chronologically, you know, but also the style of the film itself feels very youthful and fresh, which is fitting with the subject matter. I think, you know, it really felt to me like a movie about generational change in a lot of ways. You know, this idea of the changing of the guard, where Yannick and his friends represent this youthful aspiration towards the West and towards not anarchy, as you said, but a kind of freedom and just being allowed to breathe openly and spread ideas. And, you know, there's one shot, there's one image that really stuck with me, which is, I think, when the band is going to go off to play at the music festival, and they're on like I think at the airport or on an airfield, and they're crossing the screen, and they're all wearing their jeans and they're kind of like Western clothes. And then there's like
a band.
They're a band. Yeah. They're a punk band. And then there's like a group of, I think, Polish like security forces or police crossing the other way. And it's just like, those are the two, you know, colliding forces at this moment. And it's just a very stark visual, depiction of the dramatic theme. I just thought that the father figure character was very interesting, because he's sort of part of the state apparatus, but clearly, you know, very anti-communist in a certain way. But again, it's about how he navigates his public and private opinions on that, and kind of tries to not rock the boat, because he's concerned for his family. And so, again, I guess that's a theme I keep coming back to in all of these films. And then in terms of other, you know, post-communist films and how it relates, I guess one I think of, you know, from Germany, the movie Goodbye Lenin, which is also about a kind of a young Western looking, resident of East Germany, who then, of course, it's set a little bit later. It's about the wall falling and him kind of embracing the West and trying to delude his mother, who's a dyed-in-the-wool communist. But both of those films have a similar kind of youthful energy and a focus on that kind of rock and punk spirit. And they're both kind of colorful, and you get the sense in both of those films of an opening up and this kind of repressive system starting to slowly open way to new voices and new ways of expression.
To sum up this conversation, we spoke about these films, about sort of the politics, the history, but what is film as a resource of engaging and learning about history and politics? Why is it good? Why is it a useful tool? What can we learn from film that we cannot learn from other media?
Well, I guess if I can start, that Roger Ebert, who's a great American film critic, said that movies are a great way of generating empathy and just being able to put yourself in someone else's shoes. And I think that's true of great art to all extent, but film has a particularly immersive quality to it. And I think these films really do that. They put you in a very particular time and place, dealing with some very thorny moral dilemmas under a, you know, repressive regime, and they help you to understand that context a little bit better. And I think that, you know, film is also just, you know, probably the most popular art form. It's the art form that most people will be exposed to, and it's accessible. And because of that, so much historical debate, I think, is centered around how we depict history through film or TV. I mean, you know, certainly in an American context, right, you know, people used to think about slavery as it's depicted in Gone with the Wind, and now they might think about it as it's depicted in 12 Years a Slave, to cite just one example. And I think that probably a lot of these films play a similar role in Poland in kind of putting a different spin, providing a different perspective, perhaps complicating some more, you know, simplistic historical narratives for a new audience.
Thank you, Eva. Having rewatched these films, what strikes you now as you see them again?
Again, great question. I agree with Sean. That's the thing. This art form allows you to go back and rewatch. Pause and kind of allows you to look at different aspects. Every time you see perhaps new things, you relate to different things, and also as you're in a different maybe different stage of your life, different place. For me, watching Reverse 10 years ago versus last night.
As I was watching these films, I was thinking about Polish history, but I was also connecting them with other films from many different countries. We talked about film noir and Humphrey Bogart, and all that I love, that kind of punk spirit. I was thinking about this Irish film, Sing Street, or even something like Back to the Future, an American movie that ends with that kind of like very feel-good rock jam at the end. So, I think that they're very specific to Poland in one sense, but they're very universally accessible in another.
Okay, thank you so much. Thank you for all of the viewers that are with us today. I'm very, very grateful to our interlocutors, to my interlocutors, Sean Keeley and Eva Baker, as well as, which is very important, to my colleagues from behind the scenes. So Dagmara Jasińska, Jan Jasiński, her son, who are sort of co-producers of this conversation, Mateusz Nasłoński, who helped us put our promotional materials together, and anyone who sort of helped to organize this event and this showcase and sort of get it off the ground. Look out for our newsletter, the embassy's newsletter, and the information on the embassy's social media, our Facebook and Twitter, for details of dates and details of the showcase and more details about the movies. And thank you again, and please check the stories from Behind the Iron Curtain out. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.